Welcome to this edition of Christian Connections. We have a great program. This program is live right at the moment, but if you're seeing it later in the week, you have to know that today is October 31st, 2023, but that part doesn't really matter. We're going to kind of build this program loosely around the theme, and we have a special guest presenter. You know him as Harold Zapata. He's been involved with the LLBN for how long?
About a year now.
About a year?
Yes, sir.
And then, of course, everybody knows Sheila Hodgkin, longstanding board member of the Linda Broadcasting Network. And of course, just off camera is Ganem Hanna. He will be presenting his spiritual commentary in just a few minutes. It's entitled Demons and Angels. And then we're going to have some great music. And then Harold's going to take the stand to testify about who our living God is and what it means to have dates like today. All that and more on this edition of Christian Connections. Now here's Sheila to introduce the boys. They're back, Sheila.
Well, yes, they are, and we're really excited to have them. We have Liam and Luke Thomas. They're no stranger to LLBN, and I'm always so excited to see them here. And they are going to be playing They Will Know We Are Christians by Our Love.
Beautiful to have young people here performing beautiful music here at LLBN. Well, hello, folks. I love walking. I love walking, and my guess is that you love walking as well. And I like walking mostly during daytime, not night times. I like the daytime because I get to see the trees and the houses and the colors and the people. When I go out at nighttime, it's dark and doesn't give me a whole lot to see, so the walks feel longer and more boring. I like it when it's dark because I can get home, be home, and spend time with my family as well. And I'm sure we all have our preferences, day or night and so on. It's irrelevant. But during my daily walk, as I enjoy what God has created by looking at the trees and the animals and people and the colors of the houses, it disturbs me when I see symbols of the dead in people's lawn, statues of evil-looking people or monster or skeletons or grave. Someone turned their whole front yard in a graveyard that right here in Loma Linda, and it's like, wow, how sad that is, because it almost a symbolic celebration of the evil, the dead, the darkness, the demonic powers. And I know, as innocent as it might be in the minds of those who are celebrating this holiday or participating in these holidays, there's something about it just doesn't feel right. It doesn't represent the light of our Lord and Creator Jesus. Opposite of what I see during the season of this celebration called Halloween, it reminds me of something completely in opposite. Back when the Israelites were in captivity under the Egyptians, and God, one of the plagues had on the Egyptian that he was going to strike every firstborn. He was going to have an angel to strike every firstborn and take their life away for being so harsh, for keeping the Israelites captives, for slaving them, and for not giving them their freedom, and for many other reasons. They were ungodly people. So Moses, God, with his instruction through an angel, instructed Moses, and Moses instructed the people that you need to sacrifice an animal, a lamb, and brush their blood on your door or doorpost. So when the angel came at night, skipped, passed over those homes that they were marked with the blood, knowing that those are God people. But then the tragedy hit every home that was not marked with blood on it. So I can't help draw, not exactly, it's a big contrast between Halloween and what I'm just describing in the days of the Israelites and the captivity of Egypt under the Pharaoh. But the representation of who we are, who we worship, is very, very important. And again, as innocent as it might be, I think we, as Christians, we should, as believers in Christ, we need to display God's power, His light, His might, His love. Getting involved in this almost demonic activities, or feels like it is, it just feels wrong. It comes Christmas. We know that's another pagan holiday. But I can tell you, when I drive through town, I can tell who's believer in Christ, who have their lights on, the string lights and decoration on their house with white angels on the floor, not graves, not skeletons, not dead walking, not monsters, but God is light. And it's an expression, it's symbolic, hey, that we are Christians. And I think it's important that we be careful how we present ourselves as Christians. We have to present the light. We need to present God, not the dead, but the living. Not the worldly, symbolic things such as Halloween symbols or walking rabbits or whatever it might be during other occasions, but rather Jesus Himself, the Son of God. So we have the powers of demons and we have the power of angels. Of course, God's angels far greater and stronger than any demon on this earth, because they have the power of Jesus in them. They represent God, and they supersede their authority. But I think we need to shield ourselves with God's heavenly powers and symbolically present God spiritually, vocally, in gentleness and love and kindness, and all in so many ways. Not as we are where we are in markets or in malls, but also our homes needs to represent who we are and who we follow. I'll turn it over to Marlon.
Come on in and take a seat. Join us. Pastor Zapata, again, was making some observations.
Absolutely.
And, you know, not only Loma Linda, but Redlands and Wichita and, you know, Smallville, Bigville. It's all a celebration of death and the celebration of demons, it seems like. This day has kind of progressed with the times. You know, it's not as innocent as it used to be.
It used to be as innocent as Casper the Friendly Ghost. And nowadays, the stuff that's coming out of Hollywood, if we only knew how entrenched spiritism is in Hollywood, we don't even know the tip of the iceberg, how horrible this is, and how happy they are. And it's time for soldiers to get up and get the sword and strike the dragon. The only way we do that is as we remain small, humble, slippery, and use God's word that proceeds out of his mouth.
That's why you're here tonight.
Lord willing, help me, Jesus. Pray for me. Please pray for me.
We're going to get you started in just a few minutes. But, you know, you have kids. And
I do.
You may have not known the truth when you were younger. But do you know the truth about it now?
Yeah, I'm being progressive revelation. That's what's happening.
Yeah.
Yeah, it was, like you said, it was very innocent, you know. It was just fun getting candy, you know. But when you know, it's those subtle things, you know, when you get to know what's behind all that, you realize you don't want to participate in anything that has to do with celebrating the dark, you know.
Ganem, it seems to me that the world has become wicked in a major way very quickly. There are enough traps and attractions and bright lights, you know, to deceive the innocent, but today is just like a outright worship of spiritualism.
Sure seems that way, Marlon, and the ideology of material and superstars and singers and actors and actresses just seems to draw people in a more and deeper way than ever before, where they begin to idolize these people and it become a cult of its own. People throwing off themselves off balcony if they're favorite movie star died or their favorite singer or they overdose on drugs because they couldn't handle losing that individual. And that's, to me, all part of what you said, Marlon. It's the absentee of God in the hearts of so many. It's working fast. And we're living in a world that, like you said, is full of, like you call it, booby traps.
Yeah.
You know, you grow into getting hooked on a computer games where kids don't leave the rooms for 5 hours a day playing games.
I wish it was 5 hours.
You're right. Adults spending that much, if not more.
Violent games. Mm-hmm. I mean, we're not talking about.
They are, and I've seen
Mario.
Some of them. They're very sickening. You know how, and it just promotes taking the life of some other human being over and over and over and over again. It's like, where's the pleasure in that? So we do live in very unusual times, but the word of God still hovering and is still present.
Amen.
And
thank you.
But the day would come, the Holy Spirit will draw itself more and more. And I wonder if that's what we're seeing. You know, my simple way I say it, and maybe someone else have said that, you know, you look at darkness and light. Darkness to me is it's a state of absence of light. So it becomes dark. And dark in darkness overshadow the darkness and it becomes light. So we need that light to shine everywhere because darkness can be overcome by light. And Jesus is the light and the word of God is light. We're not going to save the world. Well, we're going to continue to share the good news of Jesus to light up spirits with the word of God and bring light to those who we can reach and make a difference. But you know, the enemy in the last days will be given more and more freedom to do him and his angels to do what they want to do. And it seems like it has begun.
Well, that's a perfect introduction for our guest today here on Christian Connections.
Please pray for me, so I can say.
Yeah, and well, let's have a prayer right now. Gannon,
let's do that, please, Brother Marlin. Would you like to lead it out?
Yeah, no, or Brother Gannon? Let's have Gannon do it.
Yes, yes.
Our majestic, loving God, yes, Holy Father. God, God we only God we worship and the only God we acknowledge, who's also our Father. We yes, ask Father. In your name to let the Holy Spirit be with Pastor Zapata as he expressed your words, your teaching to the crowds, to the multitudes, and let the words comes out of his mouth touch the hearts of many who are watching, and bless those who are listening, and in return they can bless those who comes around them. In your name we ask this. Amen.
Amen and amen. My assignment tonight, when I was told the date a couple of months ago, I knew immediately the title that I was going to give Brother Brother Jay, and that was The Strange World of the Occult on October 31st, as at this very moment at sunset, millions of children and their parents around the United States, 145 million people in the U.S. today will be celebrating this. And here we are in the Loma Linda Broadcasting Network. That's why I encourage you to support the truth as expressed here in this godly ministry going out into all the world. The Strange World of the Occult. When I graduated back in July 16, 1989, 2 weeks later, I was back here from Germany in the States, and I started canvassing. I was a colportor, and I was canvassing in the Los Angeles area, and I came into what we call Hispanic Botanica. I thought it was innocent enough as I saw statues and Bibles and candles. And I'm like, I have Bibles to sell also and some great books. I came inside. The lady bought some. She says, would you like to follow me in the back? I'll get your cash. I'm like, absolutely. And as I passed by and we went to the back, she had a black room with the black walls, black ceiling, black floor, an oval table with 6 or 7 places to sit down, and a red candlestick, and next to it, a skull. What goes on in here? I asked her. Well, I have a lot of people that come to me, she said, and I speak to the skull on their behalf, and the skull speaks to us back about issues that they have. They pay me money, and they get issues resolved. Now, how'd you like to get introduced into the real world after graduating from seminary with some of those things? I'm looking into the Bible. You studied it, but now you got to take out the sword because now you are really having to use it. The reality is that all of this spiritism that's being celebrated tomorrow, 1st of November, is El Día de los Muertos, the Day of the Dead, and that's why Hallowed's Eve, the Eve of the Saints, is tonight. Genesis 3:4 tells us that the serpent said unto the woman, ye shall not surely die, for God doth know that in the day ye eat thereof, your eyes shall be opened, ye shall be as gods, knowing good and evil. And the woman saw that the tree was good for food, and that it was pleasant to the eyes, a tree to be desired, to make one wise. And because of that, she took of the fruit thereof, did eat, gave it to her husband with her, and they both did eat it. And the eyes of them both were opened. Please listen. The foundational principle upon which all spiritism, the world of the occult, everything is built upon this lie. Thou shalt not surely die. The first thing that the devil does is he sends forth fascination. Hey, would you like to have a new superpower? That's kind of like everything that you see on TV nowadays, from little children's programs to the big movies on the TV screen or movie theater screens. It's all about what superpower can you have? What do you have? It all starts with fascination. She saw the tree. She was fascinated by the tree. But from fascination, it moves into form. Here, try this out. And the moment somebody tries out what they were fascinated for because of the curiosity killed the cat principle, fact is, gotcha. And that gotcha has gotten a lot of people around the world. Just a couple of examples. For example, hey, just have some people around this this beautiful Parker, now Hasbro, table game called the Ouija board. Just with some letters and numbers and your kinetic energy, you can now tap into the spirit world. Aren't you fascinated to know about the future? Aren't you fascinated to know that you can get certain things resolved, fast-tracked, so that you could be as gods? Could you communicate yourself with the spirit world and gain from that communication? Then we have books, you have potions and lotions, you have specific placed words one after another in order that so that through words, mystical magic, whether white or black, can take place. And when you least expect it, now you're into tarot cards, and people want to know about their past. They want to know about their present. They want to know about the future. Now, we start things off, like Sheila was saying, so innocently, some candies and Casper the Friendly Ghost, and then you move on to Scooby-Doo. Maybe it was just the Beatles in the 60s, and nowadays, brothers and sisters, we have some crazy movies. 50 years ago, this year, we're celebrating what happened to a young teenage boy by the name of Roland Doe in the 40s after he played with the Ouija board. From that real-life experience, a novel was written in 1971, the year I was born, and in 73, the movie The Exorcist, which has been the foundation pretty much for all opening of spiritism in Hollywood, took place. Movies like Obsession and The Conjuring and others, even innocent movies as you go into very well-known places that kids go visit every single day. You can't find a movie without a spirit. You can't find a movie without gender confusion nowadays. You can't find a movie without a witch or a warlord. You know, the devil comes into people's lives because he's invited. He's invited by the movies we see. He's invited by the books we read. He's invited by the games we play. He's invited by the music that we hear from some sort of maybe AC/DC in the 70s and then the Knights in Service of Satan Kiss, all the way today to now open satanic rituals in concerts like that of Ghost, a Swedish band, a Grammy Award winning, may I add. Brothers and sisters, it's overtly, it's out there, it's in our face. Talking about the video games that our young people play by about 8 hours each and every day, and I may add not just young people, but all people, more demonic, more lives are being taken, more affinity with things that when you put it on your conscience level and when you go to sleep, you write on your subconscious hard drive all that happened with the killing and the demonic influences and the music that happened throughout the day so that your identity in the morning is changed. Now more overtly, such as Satanism, voodoo, Macamba, Santeria. Even I was reading this morning that the Queen of England, she, wife of the King, Camilla, she can't go into certain castles that she's been given because there are spirits there. Brothers and sisters, I'm also, as you know, a real estate broker. And back when I was in the Fresno area, I took a listing. Historic Fresno area. The person who gave me the listing says, look, we haven't lived there. It's for my grandparents, but people just talk about that second story. I could not go to the second story Then what we do, usually do an agent caravan, and we had about 13 of my agents, and we all went to it. No one could go up to the second story. I mean, it's a real world out there where there are real demonic influences. Gannon was talking just a moment ago about the big box stores and all those big 10, 12 foot tall monsters that now they're placed on people's yards. It's beckoning. It's asking through the music and the videos and the books and the artifacts, begging for spirit beings to come in. But the Bible tells us in the book of Isaiah, chapter 8, verse 19, "And when they shall say unto you, seek unto them that have familiar spirits, wizards that peep, and that mutter, should not a people seek unto their God for the living to the dead, to the law and to the testimony?" Take out the Bible. "If they speak not according to this word, it's because there is no light in them." That means that all they have to produce is darkness. The Bible tells us that this is a true warfare between the lamb and the serpent. It's the age-old conflict of the ages between Christ and Satan. And the devil will not give one inch. And Christ is Lord over all. And we get to choose. Oh, what an awesome opportunity is to share this today. Let's get into this Bible study. Matthew 4, verse 1 through 4. Jesus believed in demons. The Bible says that Jesus was led by the Spirit into the wilderness to be tempted of the devil. And when the tempter came to him, he said, "If thou," he always plants seeds of doubt. Hath God really said, "If thou"? It's all about your identity. We must therefore be informed by the word what our identity is as sons and daughters of God. And Jesus answered all his ifs with, "It is written." Jesus stood behind God's word. "Man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceedeth out of the spirit of the mouth of God." Our safety is in what God has spoken. So quickly, in the 15, 14 minutes I have left, seven biblical truths that you've got to know. True number one, very, very important, the dead know nothing. The Bible says, Ecclesiastes 9:5 and 12:7, "For the living know that they shall pay taxes." We are paying taxes, but we all know that we're going to die. It's still a one-on-one. "But the dead know nothing." How much do the dead know? Say it with me. Nothing. Then, Bible says, why don't they know anything? Because the dust, the body, goes back to the earth where it came from, and the spirit shall return back unto God who gave it. So if life was God breathing the spirit in Adam's nostrils, death is now the spirit coming back to God who gave it. The Bible says the Father is the Father of spirits, and we're not approaching a mountain that trembles, but we're approaching God the Father and Jesus the Mediator and a great company of angels and the spirits of just men made perfect. The spirits come back to God in an unconscient form. Who gave it? The Bible tells us very clearly, point number two, God alone is immortal. 1 Timothy 6, the Bible says, "Until the appearing of the Lord Jesus Christ, who he is the blessed and only sovereign, the King of kings and Lord of lords, who alone has immortality." All false religions believe in the immortality of the soul. Every pagan religion, even the great Catholic Church, even the most of the Protestant churches will believe that you are an immortal soul, which means that when you die, you really don't die. But the Bible says that that is not true. The body is not immortal. It dies. It goes back to the dust where it came from. The spirit is not immortal. It goes back to God who gave it. Only God cannot die. Only God is immortal. And the Bible tells us that, number three, the dead are asleep, unconscious, but those who are dead and asleep are currently unconscious will come back to life. Let's read this. Acts 7:59, when Stephen was going to be stoned and killed, they stoned Stephen, calling upon God and saying, Lord Jesus, receive my spirit. Like Christ said on the cross, Father, into thine hands I submit my spirit. Father, Jesus, receive my spirit. And he knelt down and cried with a loud voice, Lord, lay not this sin against their charge. And they stoned him. He died. And when he had said this, the Bible says, he fell asleep. What does it mean, falling asleep? Doesn't mean he was tired and went to sleep. It means he died. John 11, verse 11 through 14, Jesus told his friends, hey, our friend Lazarus sleepeth, but I'm going to go to awake him out of sleep. How about Jesus spake of his death? And so he said to them plainly, and I hope it's coming plainly to you and me this evening through this broadcast, Lazarus is dead. The state of our dead is the body goes back to the dust where it came from. The spirit goes back to God who gave it. And they are considered at that very moment as if they are asleep. Now, Christ said, I'm going to awake him from the sleep. And we know what happened. Jesus woke him. He says, Lazarus, come forth. And one day, the day is coming when Christ with himself shall descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel and the trumpet call of God. And the dead in Christ shall rise first. Who are these? These are 1 Thessalonians 4, which are asleep, God will bring with him. And the Bible says in spirit form with the trumpet, the Bible says the Lord himself will descend from heaven with a shout, voice of archangel, trumpet of God. And with that trumpet blast, the spirits go back to the earth, into the water, into the oceans, and up come out glorified those people in the first resurrection. And then we who are alive and remain at the coming of the Lord will be raptured, caught up with them, as we will be transformed in a moment in the twinkling of an eye at the last trumpet, and we're going to be levitating ourselves up to meet the Lord in the air with them, and so shall we ever be with the Lord. Meaning, the dead were asleep, but then they were awoken by the coming of the Lord Jesus Christ and the rapture of the church, which, by the way, is the self-same event. There is no such 7 years between one and the other. I would just say in 30 seconds or so, that little 1 week that people use out there in the book of Daniel chapter 9, if you take that away from the 70 weeks, Jesus was never anointed Messiah. Jesus never died in the middle of the week. And the time of the Jews did not finish. It was only 490 years for the Jews. Take that last week, brother and sister, apostle or prophet or pastor, teacher, or evangelist, put that in the future 2,000 years, Jesus never died. Keep that in the back of your mind. The coming of Christ and the rapture, the coming up, the elect being up to heaven, taken to God, are the exact self-same event. John 5, Jesus said very clearly, verily, verily, I say unto you, the hour is coming now, it is, when the dead shall hear the voice of the Son of God. They that are in their graves shall hear his voice. And there's going to be two resurrections, that of life, we just read that there, and that of damnation, the second resurrection. Number four, if it is true that the dead know not nothing, that the body goes back to the dust where it came from, the spirit back to God who gave it, and that they will be reunited in the last day at the coming of Christ, at the rapture, then what is this about this demons and people that can talk to their loved ones? Is there truth into that? Point number four, there is a world of unseen spirits. The Bible says that Jesus made the visible and the invisible world, whether thrones, principalities, powers, all things were made by him and for him. There is a world of unseen watchers, unseen spirits. Some are good, some are bad, but they are real. The Bible tells us, in Hebrews chapter 1, verse 14, and Daniel 8, 19, are not angels, aren't they ministering spirits sent forth by God himself to minister to you and to me? They are our ministers. They serve us, who shall be heirs of salvation. And in sharing the truth with us, one of these, like Gabriel, said to Daniel in Daniel 8, he says, I've been asked to come out here to you. Behold, I'll make thee know what shall be in the last end of the indignation. For at the appointed time of the end shall be. So angels have messages. Angels bring answers. Good angels, guardian angels, cherubim, seraphim alike, these angels, covering cherubs, these are all to the ministering of God and of those of us who shall be kings and priests with God. Those of us that one day will sit even on the throne with Christ as he overcame and sat on his Father's throne. They are here to minister unto us, the great good ones. What does the Bible say about the evil ones? Ezekiel 28, 12 through 18. God did not make the devil. He made a beautiful being, perfect in beauty. If we can put this on the screen, please. You were in Eden. You were that anointed cherub that covereth. You were perfect until iniquity was found in you. Oh, Lucifer, Isaiah 14, son of the morning, how have you fallen? You said in your heart, I will ascend. I will exalt my throne. I will sit upon the stars in the congregation. I will ascend above the high. I will be like the Most High. But the Bible says there was a war in heaven. Michael and his angels fought against the dragon and his angels, but they prevailed not. Neither was there a place found with them anymore in heaven. And the great dragon was cast down, that old serpent devil, accuser, and Satan, adversary. And they deceived the whole world. And they, all of them, were cast into the earth where we are quarantined with them. And his angels were cast down with him. So we live in this world. Bible says that this world is... God is still the ruler. God is still in control. But the Bible says that he's going to allow the evil one to do a couple of things. 2 Thessalonians 2:9, 2 Corinthians 11, even him whose coming is after the working of Satan with all power, signs, lying wonders, even Satan himself can be transformed, 2 Corinthians, into an angel of light. So he wants to deceive. And these demons can be contacted. So the Bible tells us that King Saul, when Samuel died, he was afraid. The Philistines were there. They were going to go into war. And he asked his soldiers, seek me a woman with a familiar spirit. They found one, and they came by night. And he said unto her, I pray thee, in 1 Samuel 28, divine unto me by the familiar spirit. And she says, well, you know, Saul's going to kill me if I do this. He, of course, hid himself. You know what he's done with those that have familiar spirits, wizards, out of the land. He took them out. Saul says, I swear by the Lord in this witch's hut, no punishment. Just tell me, whom shall I bring unto thee? And he said, Samuel, I need to know what's going to happen tomorrow. It's all about tomorrow, tomorrow. And when she said, yeah, I see him. He's coming up. The gods ascending out of the earth, verse 13. And he said unto her, what does he look like? She said, an old man cometh up, covered with the mantle, and he stooped down, and he bowed himself. And Samuel said to Saul, why hast thou disquieted me? And he told him, look, I just don't know what to do. God's not answering. And I've called thee. And he basically said, God's become your enemy, and tomorrow at this time, you're going to be with me. Brothers and sisters, demonic activities are real. Demons can impersonate the dead. They can take on the form, even of a godly light-bearing angel, and also the form of our departed loved ones. They can speak lies, and they can speak truths, and they can speak half-truths, whatever's most convenient for them and for your destruction. They can be communicated with if you open up yourself to that spirit world and ask them in. Also, God can be communicated with if you get into the Word and let His Holy Spirit come into your life. We invite them. People invite them by the games, the books, the movies, the songs, the artifacts. Demons can tempt. Demons can oppress. And demons can even also possess. Truth number six. God prohibits the practice of the occult. Deuteronomy 18, the Bible says, when thou art therefore come into the land which the Lord thy God giveth thee, thou shalt not learn to do any, what God calls, abominations. Going inside one of these places and having your tarot cards read or your palm read or having seances and having your little ones come out of closets and talk or to you individually or having skulls speaking to you individually. Or why? Bible says these are abominations because... The Bible says this use of divination, those observers of times, those enchanters, those who are witches, charmers, consulters with familiar spirits, necromancers, those who can communicate with the dead, all these that do these things are an abomination to the Lord. Humans create the abomination. And it's come down not just in Hollywood, but it's also come down to the church. Babylon is fallen, is fallen. What made her trip up and fall? The false prophet? Yeah. The false teacher? Yeah. All of them led by the dragon and spirits coming from the dragon to make Babylon today the habitation of devils, not just found in Hollywood or out there in those producers with music, but even in the very church. The Bible tells us that God will bring forth judgments. He will bring forth judgments because of the abominations that are committed. Brothers and sisters, we don't even know the tip of the iceberg of all the abominations committed in Babylon and much less in Hollywood and around the world. But I will say this, we have seen that clearly. We have seen that clearly taking place with what happened out there just a few weeks ago, the 7th of October. Demons invading men and killing innocent people out there in Israel. Brothers and sisters, as Ganim said a moment ago, the Spirit of God is closely and surely leaving this planet Earth. Ephesians 5:11, the Bible says, therefore, what should we do tonight? Take no part in the worthless pleasures of evil and darkness, but instead rebuke and like Marlon said earlier, expose them. And how we expose them is with the Word of God. Take no part in Greek means take no part at all. Oh, pastor, does that mean putting on my cute little devil suit for the company party? Yeah, it means that. Well, what's so wrong about just taking my kids trick-or-treating? Take no part. Well, it's found in this nice channel that everyone goes to, and it's the happiest place on earth. Have no part. Don't forget, fascination leads to form, and form leads to gotcha. How much poison do you want in your water? Therefore, as we finish, demons can and must be overcome. Demons have to be overcome. And you say, okay, Harold, I'm caught in this. How do I do it? Submitting to God, resisting the devil, he shall flee from you. They overcame him by the blood of the Lamb and the word of their testimony. They overcame him with the it is written, hiding behind the breath of God in his word. In the name of Jesus, using the powerful name of Jesus, and believing that though they are strong, there is not one person that Christ has not died for the sins of witchcraft. He's died for those sins on the cross. He's paid them full on Calvary's cross. Therefore, he can bind the strong man. Jesus is stronger than the strong man. That's why I finished. Last illustration. He asked, what is your name? And the demons inside of this man out there in the outside of the lake, Gennesaret, Gadarene, he says, my name is Legion, for we are many. A legion has 6,000 soldiers in Rome. One man possessed at least by 6,000 demons, and Jesus set him free. I declare and decree today by the authority of God's word, talking to a witch, to a wizard, to a warlord today, God can change your heart, but you must want to seek greater power. God is greater than the devil. He sits on a throne, and his kingdom will last forever. The devil is a defeated foe. Christ exposed him by taking away sin, nailing it on the cross. And now there is no such more thing as a devil, an accuser. Who shall accuse? God in Christ died for all of our sins. Satan, our adversary, yeah, he's still Satan, and he's still opposing. But I declare and believe that if we submit ourselves to God, resist the devil, he shall flee from us in the mighty name of Jesus. Amen and amen.
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 Help me, Jesus.
I think you did.
Praise the Lord.
That was very nice. Thank you.
Thanks for the opportunity.
For the information. And, you know, we take it for granted, you know, those that are familiar with the scriptures about death. Death is death. But you pointed out that the majority of the Christian world believe something else. And this has only happened in the last few decades?
Yeah, the great church, the Catholic Church, with the understandings of the hell and heaven, purgatory and limbo, it sets up the whole table for, if I can communicate with people who've gone beyond the grave for good things, then that's white magic. If I can communicate then with the people for egotistical things and or casting spells on other people, manipulating, then now it's black magic, but it's all magic. And what Christ is saying is the devil's very clear. Hath God really said, this is where he's staking his claim. And it's on the immortality of the soul. The most important thing that a Christian can do is believe the truth. That what God said, when he said, the day you eat of it, you shall surely die. It means the body goes back to the dust, the spirit goes back to God who gave it. And they're both unconscious until the resurrection. That means I cannot communicate with the dead. And somebody does come out of the closet and sit in my bed and talk to me for the next 12 weeks after my husband or wife passed away. It's not my husband or wife. It's a demonic entity, and they have the right to do that if we give it to them. Absolutely.
That actually happened in my extended family.
Okay.
So I know that it's real, and you know, of course, we've all had our personal experiences where we wonder, you know, is it muttering or peeping, shadow people and all that kind of stuff. This is kind of a world that, because we know the Bible and we know the truth, we think we're protected. Are we?
If we make ourselves small and slippery and stay behind the word, we're protected. If we think, because I'm an Adventist and I've got the truth, the real question is, does the truth have you? And when the moment comes to make decisions, are we simply going moment by moment saying, not my will, but thy will be done, it is written. That's all. So we are protected as we stay behind, it is written. But the moment we kind of look up, it's not good. You got to stay small and slippery.
Yeah, I wish you would expand on that if I were an Adventist, but it's more than Adventist. It's yes. Really the majority are just don't know any better. They just trust what man says to them just because he's in a pulpit and seems to have some authority. Should we discard what the scripture says, Gavin?
No, I mean, that's the very foundation of our faith, of our relationship with God. I think if we're uncertain about something, we should go back to the Bible and get to the source of the information, especially at this age where you can almost Google anything you want and you can find the passages in the Bible to answer your questions. And even when you see that passage from Google, go back to open the Bible, make sure it's not taken out of context. The truth is always there. But, you know, you're talking about devil. It's a very clever being and knows how to deceive. A lot of times folks think devil is God's counterpart. He is not. He is nowhere near the power of God, as you mentioned in your sermon. He was casted down. God deceived him. So now, I mean, God defeated him. And now his job is to deceive us before God. That's the only way he can get back at God, by deceptions on us. And we tend to, and then we start drifting away from God, from the truth, by these deceptions. Hollywood is a perfect place. You know, I was a movie junkie. I love movies. I love anything about video and movies. And I just watch movies for the sake of just catching errors or mistakes or wrong camera angle or bad edit or for the effects they have. That's what half of the movies, I don't remember the plot or the story because I was fascinated by that. But now, as I don't watch those things and I go watch a movie from time to time, an all black and white or something, evil and deception and killing is way from back, even the movies from the 50s. You know, we say how things were innocent back then, right? In contrast with today, that is, right? But when I go back and I see an old classic movie, 50 years old, 60 years old movie, one of the earlier movies, killing and shedding blood, it just, the effects weren't as. So Satan always been at work. Except now, He's empowered. He's tapping into the hearts and minds of more people, deceiving many. And another point you made, you know, those who are running these Hollywood companies and big things, they're not of godly origin. They're deceived so much that deceiving others for them is conviction. It's conviction and the false ideology. And to them, that's the world they live in. It gets darker because there's no light there. Mm-hmm. And when there's no light, there's darkness.
Exactly.
And that's exactly what's going on, what's being fed in the minds of children, young adults. And if someone tells me these are not the signs of the last times, then I'm not sure what would be. Satan is at work. However, God is at work as well. And God's work is beautiful and outcast and outshines everything the devil is doing.
Sheila, tell me about the Jesus power to save and overcome anything that is overcoming us.
Well, I think that's what Satan does. He tries to make us fear. Halloween's yes. about fear. Well, and so. I think I like what in Luke 10:19 it says, I've given you power and authority over the enemy that nothing shall harm you. Hmm. And I think with Jesus won the victory. You stand behind Jesus. We have power over the enemy because yeah. Jesus is in us. The Holy Spirit is in us. So we shouldn't fear. That's what the devil fears, that we will know that we have power over him because of Jesus Christ.
Well said.
He's just kind of saying that coercion always means Satan. And love and free choice mm-hmm. always means Jesus.
Amen. Mm-hmm. Praise the Lord.
I see one of the Thomas brothers on the stage here. Sheila, tell us about what is going to happen next.
Well, we get to hear once again from Liam Thomas, and he's going to be playing Great is Thy Faithfulness, one of my favorites.
Thank you.
Well, another pair of brothers we can watch grow up here at Christian Connections.
Oh, so, God, it's so good.
Aren't isn't it amazing to see the future of the remnant growing up? You know, we're not running out of them. Although we need more.
Yeah, the Lord said if he did not leave that remnant, we should all be like Sodom and Gomorrah. The reality is that the future is in good hands as the Lord leads the future with young talent like that. Absolutely.
Now, Pastor Zapata, I want to thank you for joining us and telling us about life and death and the occult, especially on this not very significant day. And we want to thank you for your support of the ministry. I'm going to turn the television over to Ganem Hanna so that he can share and have the last word about the support.
Well, let me share with you. 2 Timothy chapter 1, verse 7 says, God did not give you a spirit of fear. Listen carefully. But rather give you a spirit of power, love, and self-control. So here's God gave us everything we need to cope in this world in spite of what's going on in it. He is empowered us. And we ask you to help us continue sharing the good news of Jesus in the world that is darkening and darkening. But we want to shine the light of Jesus in the hearts of men and women around the world. And your support, as our support together, matters to keep these kind of programs going on the air 24/7 for his glory and for his kingdom that you and us will be in one day.
See you next time on Christian Connections.